honor to introduce Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, who will be delivering the inaugural Dr. Sunidhi Solomon oration today. I'm sorry my travel schedule is preventing me from being there in person. Dr. Sunidhi Solomon, my mother, was someone who was very hard to impress. However, Dr. Soumya was one of the very few people whom she really admired and respected, both as a clinician and a researcher in India. A couple of years ago, my mom was in an international meeting where there was someone senior speaking about tuberculosis in India, and from what I understand from my mother, their talk was either incorrect or it was not up to date. During the discussion that followed, Dr. Soumya corrected the speaker in a very diplomatic manner, without fearing any consequences, or that the speaker was someone who was highly respected in the international community. That evening, my mom narrated this incident to me and then said, "India needs more researchers like Soumya if we need to move forward in science." And today, Dr. Soumya Swaminathan is the Director General of the ICMR. I am sure my mother would have been very proud of you. When the organizers of ASICOM sent me a list of individuals to choose a speaker for this oration, it wasn't an easy task. But Dr. Soumya is someone who reminds me a lot of my mother. She is charismatic, well-spoken, internationally renowned for her research, not afraid to speak her mind, a great leader, but most importantly, she is also a woman from Tamil Nadu. You cannot go anywhere internationally and talk about HIV or TB in India and not know who Dr. Soumya is. It is for these reasons that I believe Dr. Soumya is well suited to deliver this inaugural oration. And I'm also pretty certain that even if it were up to my mother, she probably would have chosen Soumya as well. Congratulations, Dr. Soumya, on all your achievements, and I wish you the very best for your future.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar and Dr. Mohanty, especially Dr. Mohanty, for your two kind words. I don't think I can live up to the description that you gave. It's indeed a very great honor and privilege for me to deliver this oration in the name of Dr. Sunidhi Solomon, whose presence today is very badly missed by all of us, I'm sure. I'd like to thank Sunil for his very sweet message that he has sent. He couldn't be with us today. But when we heard the news of Dr. Sunidhi passing away a few months ago, it was really a shock to all of us. And most of us, even those who knew her very well, did not know that she had been not keeping well. And you know, we were upset and we asked Sunil, why didn't you tell us? You know, we could have come and met her, at least instead of this terrible shock. And he said, you know, that she did not want people to know. She wanted people to remember her, you know, as she usually was. And moreover, she believed that she was going to overcome this and come back to work in a few months. And but that was not to be, and it's really our loss, India's loss and the world's loss. She was not a woman that you could put into a box. She, apart from being, you know, a fantastic microbiologist who served in the Madras Medical College for many years, she was married to a very famous cardiac surgeon, Dr. Solomon Victor. She then left on based on her principles. She gave up government service because she was asked to do something that was not against her principles, and then set up YRG Care. At that time, HIV had just, in fact, she along with Dr. Jacob John at CMC were the first to detect HIV infection in sex workers who had been taken, rescued from Mumbai and taken to Tamil Nadu, and they were being housed in a home there. She detected the first six cases. It was met, of course, with a lot of absolute shock and all sorts of other reactions across India, disbelief, denial, anger, and a lot of stigma. And I think in those first few years, those people who were diagnosed as HIV infected, they really went through hell because of the kind of stigma that they had to face and the kind of brutal acts that you know, people had subjected them to. There was very little known about HIV. There were lots of myths and misconceptions about how it spreads, a lot of panic and rumors. Sunidhi was one person at that time who decided that, you know, she would take it on, the challenge. one of the first people to set up voluntary counseling and testing center at YRG. There was no antiretroviral treatment, so it was only a question of taking care of opportunistic infections. But the main thing was that these people felt that, you know, they had somebody to care for them. And many of the early activists, the HIV positive network, those who founded them, like Ashok Pillai and others, were also taken care of by her at the YRG care. It's very unusual also for an NGO to become a leading research institute. So she was able to blend these different aspects of caring for patients, of doing community outreach, of being an advocate for HIV, fighting for their rights, and at the same time doing world-class research. And the YRG Care today is recognized as one of the places in the world that really produces top-class research on all aspects of HIV, whether it's drug resistance, whether it's treatment, or whether it's prevention. And we have, of course, been part of many multicentric global trials. This is a quote that appeared in the New York Times, one of the obituaries, and I think it's really very one of the best things that was written about her, because it was true that people predicted that India was going to go the way of Africa, that our population would be decimated by HIV. And so Michael Spector said that, you know, it didn't happen in part because India had Suniti Solomon and a few other people like her who really took the challenge against all odds to, you know, fight this. So I think we, all of us who work in this field, should dedicate ourselves or rededicate ourselves, because there's still many more challenges ahead in the field of HIV and TB and other infectious diseases. And not be, she was one person who would never be discouraged or bowed down because of a challenge. She took it up as a challenge and she then went ahead and fought for it. She did many other things. She ran a service for HIV infected women, where they got together as an NGO and started producing handicrafts. So there was an income generation, livelihood aspect. She started the first ambulance service in Chennai city. It now, of course, it's become the 108, taken over by government, which was one of the first to produce, have ambulances that would attend to trauma victims, and many other things. She was always very generous of her time and her advice. So to move on now, I'm going to talk to you today about HIV-TB, especially with more towards drug resistance. These are, of course, some of the challenges. We all know that there's a lot of latent TB, particularly in India. About half our population is infected with mycobacterium, and TB is still the commonest infection and the leading cause of death. And now, of course, with MDR and XDR-TB, our HIV-infected people are very, very prone to that as well. So in terms of TB burden, India is number one, obviously, because of our population. Of the 2.5 million or so odd cases, about 1.5 million are treated in the RNTCP. The rest are outside the RNTCP, mostly in the private sector. The mortality estimates range from anything from 300,000 to 500,000 per year. And we'll talk a little bit more about HIV prevalence and MDR-TB. Now, over the last 10 or 15 years, we've scaled up the HIV program so that now the majority of TB patients in the country are tested for HIV infection, but still there's variation. In the northern states, particularly where the prevalence is low and where there are fewer testing centers, ICTCs, the proportion of TB patients tested for HIV is less. But if you come down to the south, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and so on, close to 95% to 98% of people are tested. The proportion who are HIV positive also varies. If you go to Delhi, neighboring Haryana, and still parts of UP, Rajasthan, Bihar, the proportions are 2, 3, 4%. But we come down again to southern Maharashtra, northern Karnataka, you get co-infection rates of 30, 40%. So there's a lot of heterogeneity in the HIV co-infection in the different parts of the country. But one challenge we still have is the people who are being referred for TB diagnosis. And very recently, we looked at this and we found that even now, only about 15 to 20% of HIV symptomatics are being referred for TB, and from the ART centers it's even less. Or even if they are being referred, people don't often reach the place where they're supposed to get tested. This is just a little fact about TB having originated in Africa, which is where, you know, mankind originated, mm-hmm. and then from Africa there was migration to different parts of the world. So TB has evolved with Homo sapiens. It's, you know, also more than about 50,000 years old. And what has happened is that the lineages have diverged, and now there are different strains of TB which affect people in different parts of the world. And when you do whole genome sequencing, which is becoming more common now, we can see that even in India we have different strains. In the south, for example, we have more of the East African Indian strain. In the north, it's more of the Central Asian strain, or CAS. There's a Beijing strain as well, which is common in the northeast. And some of these strains are more prone to drug resistance than other strains. We still don't completely understand why, but obviously there's something about the genome that makes them more susceptible to mutations. We'll come back to NDR in a bit, but there are many clinical challenges. I'd like to just go through quickly about some diagnosis and treatment aspects. We know there's more extrapulmonary disseminated TB, and therefore you need to do a lot of active case finding. This was a study that we had done looking at people who have cough and negative sputum smear. So they were chest symptomatics but sputum negative. The X-ray in this case had a sensitivity of about 70% and a specificity of only 57%. So we must remember that a normal chest X-ray does not rule out TB. And at the same time, smear negative, what we call smear negative TB based on an abnormal X-ray, could indeed be other opportunistic infections. So this was a meta-analysis that was published a few years ago, showing that if you have a combination of cough, fever, night sweats, and weight loss, it's a very good screening tool. So if you have lots of HIV positive people in the clinic, say in an ART center, and if you ask everybody who walks into the clinic, you have cough, fever, night sweats, and weight loss, and if they say no, then the negative predictive value for TB is about 98.5%. So it's a good, it has a good negative predictive value. However, if people say yes to any of these questions, then they should be further referred for TB investigations. Now, I think you've heard in the previous lecture from Dr. Amita a lot about the newer molecular diagnostics, so I don't have to spend a lot of time. In Mumbai particularly, we have a lot of gene expert machines, so I think patients have access. In the rest of the country, there's not that much of access. But there are 30 ART centers now in the southern states where gene expert is being offered to all HIV positive symptomatics. Now the advantage is it's more sensitive than smear, though not as sensitive as culture, and it's got a high specificity. It's also very good in certain extrapulmonary TB, especially lymph node aspirates, pus, and CSF. So this shows a meta-analysis again. With overall sensitivity of about 70% and very high specificity. Right. Now in India, this was first tested in about 18 sites. This was a pilot study. And this was the initial performance that was, you can see that among HIV positive TB suspects, the positivity by gene expert was about 28%, which was more than double that by smear microscopy. Similarly, in pediatrics, it doubled the yield from 5% to 10%. Now following this, we have more data in pediatric subjects. There's a 4-city project going on, and more than 15,000 children have been tested, all kinds of TB. And it's been found that we have a positivity rate of about 8% with the gene expert. But what is more worrying and surprising is that you're able to pick up a lot of unexpected drug resistance, rifampicin resistance. And on an average, about 6 to 8% of those children are turning out to have MDR-TB or rifampicin resistance, which was really not expected. Now the disadvantages of expert are the cost and the fact that it's a proprietary machine, and therefore there are a lot of things in the works now, and particularly the one over here, it's made by an Indian company, the Mol Bio, which is currently under evaluation by ICMR and DPT. So if the advantages are it's a battery operated one, so it's more point of care than an expert. It's a chip based technology. There are no cartridges which you have to throw away, so there's less waste. And it's also very easy to operate and run it. It looks very promising. We're currently completing the evaluation. And if it's found to be as good as expert, then this can be scaled up. And it can be taken down even to the primary health center level. Of course, what we need now are tests which also give you data on resistance to other drugs apart from rifampicin. So again, the Lyme probe assay, I'm sure you heard about in the previous talk. The only problem or disadvantage is that you need a sputum positive specimen, a smear positive specimen to really get a yield with the Lyme probe assay. Whereas, though it's highly specific, the advantage is that it identifies both isoniazid and rifampicin mutations, and the later version of this, which also tests for second line drugs like quinolones, aminoglycosides, and ethambutol. Now, one other test that's been used, especially in HIV infected people to diagnose TB, is the lipoadenovirin, which is a glycoprotein from the cell wall. And there's now an ELISA as well as a rapid test available, a strip test. It's not available in India, but a lot of evaluation has been done in Africa. And you can see that it's more sensitive in HIV positive people compared to HIV negative. And the highest sensitivity is in people with very low CD4 counts, those who are severely ill and hospitalized. So in that group, the LAM test, especially if it is combined with a gene expert test, would give you fairly good sensitivity of diagnosis. So in very sick patients where the sputum smear may be negative, the urine LAM test may actually make a very rapid diagnosis. Now, children are often forgotten or left out or neglected, again, because the diagnosis of TB needs, you have to make more effort to make a diagnosis of TB in children. You have to collect a proper respiratory specimen. They cannot bring out sputum. But this study, which is a large cohort from Southeast Asia, the Treat Asia pediatric HIV cohort, showed that quite a large number of them, the children had developed tuberculosis, and about 5% had died. I'll show you some data that we've collected from the ERT centers. So basically, one needs to remember that you have to go for other kind of specimens, a gastric aspirate, a nasopharyngeal aspirate, induced sputum, and or a lymph node aspirate to make a diagnosis. TB is often undetected in HIV-infected or severely malnourished children, and very often what's thought it to be pneumonia has later on been found in autopsy studies. And in this particular meta-analysis, they found that in HIV-infected children who were admitted with so-called pneumonia and who were being treated for pneumonia, 10% actually had TB. So we know that TB incidence is very much related to the immune status, and therefore the lower the CD4 count, the higher the incidence of TB. This has been known for quite some time. And I'll run very quickly through some of these trials, because these are all a few years old now, but just to show that the value of early antiretroviral therapy. This was one of the first trials, the CIPRA trial that was done in Haiti, that showed that if you start ART early, you can, rather than waiting for CD4 count to fall below 200, you can reduce TB incidence by half. Similarly, the SAPID trial that was done in South Africa, which randomized people to either start ART during TB treatment or after TB therapy, showed that mortality could be reduced by 50% by starting ART within the first few weeks of TB treatment. This was a Camellia trial that was done in Cambodia. It also showed you could reduce mortality by starting ART earlier. So early initiation of ART is very, very important in terms of reducing mortality. And that's when then the WHO guidelines actually changed and said everybody with TB should be started on ART regardless of CD4 counts. Exactly when to start is still a question, because you have to balance mortality against adverse events and iris. And again, iris is more common the more immunosuppressed the patient. And though iris usually does not kill the patient, but there are very rare instances where CNS iris can result in death. But otherwise, it's just a difficult clinical situation that you have to manage. This was the ACTG 5221, where YRJ Care and NARI were also part of this global trial, which also showed that the early ERT actually reduced age defining events and death, especially in patients with very low CD4 counts below 50. So based on that, the WHO guidelines a few years ago made this change, and you also, all of you I'm sure, know about what the first line preferred regimens are. Now, one clinical problem we often have is, what about patients on second line ART on the protease inhibitor based therapy who develop TB? We know we cannot use rifampicin because of the drug interactions, so we have to use rifabutin. Now, the study that we did showed that the Cmax or the peak level of rifabutin was below the therapeutic level in 70% of patients, and this did correlate with poor outcomes. This was when rifabutin was being used in the dose of 150 mg 3 times a week with a thrice weekly DOT. And based on that, NAPO then changed the guidelines to use either 300 mg thrice weekly or wherever daily regimen is being used to try rifabutin, to give rifabutin 150 mg daily. We still don't know the dosage in children, and we know that rifabutin can cause uveitis and leukopenia in some cases, so we do need to still work out the children. Now we're doing a PK study in 4 ART centers looking at the new dosing of rifabutin. So this is just to show that you have to be mindful of drug interactions, because rifampicin is a potent inducer of the cytochrome P450, especially the CYP3A4, and the PIs and NNRTIs are either inhibitors or inducers, both of the CYP enzymes and the PGP transporter. So there can be a lot of drug interactions, and one needs to study that before you combine drugs. This just shows that for nevirapine on the right side, there's a systematic reduction when you give it with rifampicin. But for efavirenz, you cannot predict. In some cases, it stays the same. In some patients, it goes up, and in some people, it comes down. So efavirenz drug levels and with rifampicin are very unpredictable and probably depend on the genotype of the patient, whether they're a CYP3A4, they have a polymorphism or not. So the efavirenz PK really is based on the pharmacogenomics of the patient and not on the rifampicin. So this was a study we did quite some time back, which showed that you can increase the nevirapine levels to therapeutic by increasing the dose from 200 to 300 milligrams twice daily. So in patients who cannot take efavirenz for whatever reason, the option is to give nevirapine at higher doses. So I think this is about the TB treatment in HIV infected. And now the guideline says that all TB patients who are HIV infected should receive a daily treatment throughout, or at the most you can give thrice weekly in the continuation phase. And the rationale was based on the meta-analysis of a number of studies, including a study done by us in Chennai, which showed higher risk of recurrence and failure and acquired rifampicin resistance in those who were given thrice weekly treatment. So now the standards of TB care in India also talk about this as of being the first line regimen for all patients, with an extension of the continuation phase whenever there is extensive disease or disseminated disease. You know that there are 26 standards in the standards of TB care. It's a very good document. And the standard 10 there talks about TB and HIV and basically talks about all these principles of treatment. Now there is a trial going on at NIRT Chennai, which is comparing daily and intermittent TB. This is the only trial anywhere in the world. And essentially the interim findings show that if you look at the 2-month culture conversion, there's significantly more when the drugs are given daily. And another analysis that we did, looking at patients with and without HIV infection, basically showed that acquired rifampicin resistance, the main risk factor is prior resistance to isoniazid, and the second important risk factor is having HIV infection. So even in HIV uninfected people, those who have isoniazid resistance and are treated with a thrice weekly regimen have a 10 times higher odds of developing acquired rifampicin resistance. Again, HIV infected people are prone both to reinfection and to reactivation. So you can have a cure of TB treatment and then you can get reinfected And this shows the spoligotyping or the RFLP typing in four sets of patients. You can see that the patterns on bands are completely different, showing that they were reinfected with a new strain. In fact, one of these patients had three times reinfection, with each time with a different strain. And many of these are picked up nosocomially. So it's best to try to separate HIV patients from TB patients, both in the outpatient and in the inpatient setting. Again, we recently looked at treatment outcomes from all the ART centers in Tamil Nadu, so about 2,400 patients who were treated. The favorable outcomes, that is cure and treatment completion, was seen in about 70%. And deaths were quite high, 15%, in spite of the fact in Tamil Nadu there's a good referral to the ART centers. Another 10% had defaulted. So outcomes in HIV-TB co-infected people in India are still not up to the mark. We have to identify the reasons why there's still such a high mortality. Partly they could be coming late, partly they could be having drug resistance which has been missed. Some of the factors are a low BMI, a low CD4, and an advanced clinical stage at the beginning of ATT correlated with poor outcomes. XDR-TB, we had a child who was just 13 years old. She had been treated several times for TB earlier, private sector, and then came last year with pulmonary with cough, and she X-ray showed TB. And you can see that her drug sensitivity profile was resistant to iron interferon, ethambutol, ofloxacin, kanamycin, ethionamide, streptomycin. So this is the kind of patterns now that one is seeing, and I think in Mumbai you probably see much more of this. Luckily, she responded to the XDR-TB treatment and she's doing well, and you can see that her X-ray also improved. But this is not the usual rule. XDR-TB, only about a third to 40% of patients actually respond to treatment. In general, in the community-based surveys we have from four states, MDR among new cases is in the range of 2 to 3%, among previously treated cases anywhere between 12 to 17%. But what we're seeing now is more and more fluoroquinolone resistance, even among new TB cases as well as among MDR-TB cases, and increasing rates of XDR-TB. So these are the criteria in India by which patients are referred for testing for MDR-TB. Ideally, every TB patient should have a drug susceptibility test and a baseline, and that's a basic principle of microbiology. The problem is we don't have enough lab capacity to be able to offer that, and that's why we have all these criteria. But for HIV-infected TB suspects, everybody should have upfront either a gene expert or if there's sputum positive Lyme probe assay test, and then we put on the appropriate treatment. So the model of care in the RNTCP is that if there is a patient who needs a susceptibility test, the sputum is collected, packed very safely in a biosafety box, sent to the nearest culture DST lab. Results come back usually within a week, conveyed to the patient, and if they have MDR, then they are sent off to the DRTB center. These DRTB, I think we have about 120 now in the country. They're specially made wards which have a lot of good ventilation and so on. And then they're started there on treatment, kept for a few days, and if they're well enough, the evaluation is done, and then they're sent away with a treatment box. Now, of course, they're all put on a standardized treatment regimen, which we call the category 4 regimen, and category 5 for XDR. But what we're seeing now, and I'm sure Amita Joshi and others are finding the same thing, that if you do whole genome sequencing, then you find many of these MDR patients actually have a lot of drug resistance to other groups of drugs like quinolones, like second-line injectables like capreomycin, kanamycin, even to PAS, cycloserine, and even to linezolid. So ideally, we should have a second-line DST pattern also known before we start treatment for MDR-TB. And the program is now thinking about individualizing TB treatment based rather than going with a standardized regimen. Now for isoniazid-resistant TB, there are no clinical trials done anywhere. It's surprising. So we really don't know what is a good regimen to treat these patients with. And now because we're doing these Lyme probe assay tests, more and more patients are being diagnosed with isoniazid resistance. So there's a clinical trial going on now in Chennai where we're looking at regimens with either an aminoglycoside or with a fluoroquinolone or with both. What we do know is that patients with INH resistance do not do well with the standard category 1 or category 2 regimens. This was an analysis from programmatic data which showed that about 50% of patients actually failed when they were started on these standard category 1 or category 2 regimens. And of those 50%, if you did a DST, you found that 40% of those had actually acquired rifampicin resistance. So I told you earlier that if you have isoniazid resistance and you're treated with an intermittent regimen, there's a high chance of developing MDR. And this is data from Dr. Singla from NITRD, when he looked at patients who had both INH and rifampicin sensitive compared to INH resistant. You can see that the cure rates are much lower and the failure rates are much higher when treated with category 1. So how do we treat drug-resistant TB? We have to make, construct a regimen with at least 4 active drugs taken from the different groups, from the group 1, which is pyrazinamide or ethambutol, group 2 are the aminoglycosides, group 3, quinolones, group 4 is either ethionamide or cycloserine or terazinone, and then the group 5 drugs are those which what we call our reserve drugs, but we're using them more and more now for treatment of XDR. So these are the regimens used in the program for MDR and XDR TB. And you can see the large number of drugs. They are quite toxic as well, and the tolerability is a big problem. And despite that, the treatment outcomes for MDR TB globally are only about 45% to 50% cure. However, children seem to respond better. The problem is children are not being diagnosed with MDR-TB because they're not being tested. But once they're diagnosed and put on treatment, the success rate in this meta-analysis was more than 80%. You can see here, this was from about 10 studies, but very few children being reported globally. So I'll not go into the adverse events. The other problem with MDR in children is that there are no child-friendly drugs available, and therefore you're ending up breaking capsules, breaking tablets, and it's a huge load for the child, let alone the injectable as well. There are many reviews available, and these are the dosing chart that's available on the website of the Sentinel Project for those who are interested in knowing more. What about new drugs? There is a pipeline of new drugs for TB, and a few of them are now in phase 2 and phase 3 clinical trials. At least now we have some new drugs for TB after a gap of more than 40 years, because after rifampicin, there was no new class of drugs till we have bedaquiline and delaminin now. So this is some data from the phase 2 trial of bedaquiline, which showed that when bedaquiline is added to a background regimen of MDR-TB, you can actually improve the culture negativity. There's, you can see that at 12 weeks and 16 weeks, more patients with bedaquiline were culture negative compared to those with a placebo. And also when you look at treatment outcomes, based at the end of treatment, it's almost double the number of patients, 60% versus 30% who were cured. So bedaquiline looks like a very promising drug, and the only concern is with the QT prolongation that it has. So when it is combined with other drugs like clarithromycin and the quinolones, the QT prolongation has to be watched very carefully, and patients that have a history of arrhythmias cannot be started on this. The other new drug is delaminid. This is a drug that's been made by a Japanese company called Otsuka. And again, the phase 2 data, you can see that compared to placebo, patients who were given delaminid was associated with an increased sputum culture conversion at 2 months. So this is another promising drug. Then linezolid has also been shown in trials to have good culture conversion rates with the both MDR and XDR TB patients. But again, the only drawback of linezolid is that it has a high incidence of anemia, peripheral neuropathy, and bone marrow suppression. So patients need to be monitored very carefully. Another new drug is PA824, what is now called protominant. This was a drug developed by the TB Alliance, and it's being used both for drug-sensitive and MDR TB. Again, it's been tested in various doses ranging from 50 up to 1,200 milligrams. It's quite well tolerated. It's now undergoing trial in drug-sensitive TB. It's called the STAND trial. It's looking at 3 different regimens with 100 and just PA824, MOXI, and pyrazinamide, the 3 drug regimen. In MDR-TB, there's a trial going on in Delhi where PAMC is being tested compared to the standard category 4 regimen, and another regimen where PA824 is added to the category 4 regimen. So this is a new model for drug combination therapy in TB. Earlier it used to be that you add one drug at a time, and so clinical trials used to take a very long time to establish a new regimen. But now the concept is that as soon as you can test these drugs in the in vitro and in mouse to show that they're active, you can actually combine more than one new drug and test combinations therapy. So there are many new combinations that are being tested. Even there are 2-month regimens which are being tested, like bedaquiline, delaminin, bedaquiline with moxib and pyrazinamide and so on. This is called the truncate study, which is being done in several Southeast Asian countries. So the idea is, if you can cure people with all forms of TB, because these are all new classes of drugs, you don't need to do drug susceptibility testing at baseline. But whether we'll be able to achieve this 2-month cure, we don't know. We have to wait for the trial. Similarly, there were several trials done using fluoroquinolones to try and shorten treatment. There was a Remox trial, moxifloxacin, the Oflotarb, the Gatti, and Rifaquin trial, which used rifapentine and moxifloxacin. All three were published in the New England Journal last year, but none of them showed non-inferiority. So, which means that 4-month is not as good as 6-month regimen. The only one that still is quite promising is the one at NIRT Chennai, where we added moxifloxacin to the standard 4 drugs in drug susceptible TB, and so far it looks as though the 4-month regimen seems to be working quite well. So bedaquiline will shortly be introduced in India through the RNTCP at pilot sites, maybe 5 or 6 sites, as a conditional access program in adults with pre-XDR and XDR TB after obtaining informed consent, and they will receive bedaquiline in addition to a individualized treatment regimen. And there will be very close monitoring and pharmacovigilance done before this can then be scaled up across, because there are very few treatment options now for patients with pre-XDR and XDR TB. There's also a STREAM trial for MDR TB, which is basically looking at this 9-month regimen that was originally described from Bangladesh. So the phase 1 of STREAM is already over. It was done in 3 countries. And now 2 more regimens are going to be added, and India will be part of this trial. There will be a fully oral 9-month regimen, which will be really nice because you can do away with the kanamycin injections. And there will also be a 6-month regimen. And if it works, it will be fantastic if we can actually reduce treatment to 6 months. So the 6-month regimen for MDR will include bedaquiline, levofloxacin, clofazimine, pyrazinamide, high-dose INH, and kanamycin. There are also approaches now using host-directed therapies. Apart from attacking the bacteria, can we actually stimulate the host immune system? And people, of course, have tried stem cells, but there are also a number of what are called repurposed drugs that are being used for other indications which are already in the market, which are now being found to have an impact on the immune system, particularly drugs like metformin that stimulates autophagy. It stimulates the killing, intracellular killing of mycobacteria within macrophages. There are drugs like Xyluton, which is an anti-asthma drug. It's a LIPO5 lipooxygenase inhibitor. And Xyluton has been found to increase the level of prostaglandins, and that in turn again stimulates the interferon gamma response to kill mycobacteria. There are vaccines like Mycobacterium W, which have been tried. So far, none of the vaccines have really been found to be useful as a therapeutic vaccine. People are testing micronutrients like vitamin D, zinc, and so on. So there are many, many new approaches now to treatment of TB, apart from trying the new combinations of anti-TB drugs. So what we really need are more clinical trials, and I think we have to do more of these in India. So just, this is some data from using metformin, which was an analysis done in Singapore, showing that of those patients with TB who had diabetes and who were treated with metformin or not treated with metformin, the metformin group had better outcomes. They had less mortality, and it was also associated with less incidence of latent TB. So very quickly, in the last few minutes, I just want to mention about pharmacokinetics, because I think it's very important, it's neglected. This shows that as a child grows into an adult, the pharmacokinetics of drugs changes because of changing body composition. And therefore, there are many factors that affect pharmacokinetics of TB and HIV drugs, which have to be kept in mind, including malnutrition, the pharmacogenetics, and enzyme inducers. So in children, these are the factors that have been found to influence the drug PK. And we can see in this slide that if you look at the left column, which is children 1 to 3 years of age compared to the older children, they have much lower peak values of rifampin, INH, and pyrazinamide. So this is because of faster metabolism of the drugs. If you compare TB, children with TB and HIV-infected TB patients, again you find quite a big difference in the levels of rifampicin. And this was irrespective of antiretroviral treatment. So it's very... this was also correlated with the outcomes. So the children, HIV-infected children who had low rifampicin levels, some of them had levels close to zero, also had poor outcomes. So it shows that the younger children need much higher levels of dosing, and some modeling that we've done shows that in children under 2, you need to go up to 20 mg per kg of rifampicin to achieve the same levels as you get with 10 mg per kg in older children or adults. Ultimately, how do we prevent TB? Immune status is the key. So early diagnosis, the test and treat approach, detect HIV early, put them on antiretroviral treatment, keep the CD4 counts high. That's probably the best method of TB prevention. And also it's much more than the preventive therapy that's given with isoniazid or other combinations. These are all the different trials. The Botusa trial in Botswana showed that 36 months of INH was more efficacious than 6 months, especially among those who were tuberculin skin test positive. Similarly, in South Africa, there were 4 regimens, and that showed that 6 months and 36 lifelong was similar efficacy. In India, we showed that 6 months with the ambitol INH and 36 months had a similar efficacy. In Brazil, they showed that implementation of a whole package, so that's intensified case finding, doing the tuberculin skin testing, and then targeting INH preventive therapy, reduced TB incidence in their ART clinics. But there's very limited experience of this in Asia Pacific. So we worked with NACO, and we started doing this enhanced screening for TB in 12 ART centers across the country, and this is data from adults. Basically, if you just look at the left-hand side, more than 4,000 people were enrolled and followed in the study, and they were every time they came to the clinic, they were asked if they have symptoms, and then they were tested for TB. It was found that the prevalence of undiagnosed TB was almost 1%, was about 0.8%. And when we followed them up, the TB incidence was 2.5 per 100 person years. Significant amount of TB in the ART clinics which was not being detected. Similarly, in children, we screened about 1,200, about 355 were symptomatic, but only about 57 actually made it to the RNTCP center. And of them, 30% were diagnosed to have TB. So when you screen and diagnose, but there are many children that are lost along the way. Again, the prevalence of undiagnosed TB was 1% among the children who were attending the ART center, and TB incidence was quite high. So this shows that an intensified TB screening in ART centers is very useful and can detect a lot of TB. And the rest of them who don't have TB can then be started on isoniazid prevention. So this is now being done in 30 ART centers across the country, and probably based on the results of that pilot, the NACO will then scale it up everywhere. Ultimately, we need to also integrate services. Nowadays, people have to go separately for TB services, somewhere else for ART, somewhere else for their maternal child, if they need opioid substitution somewhere else. So really, we should work towards how do we integrate care so that people don't have to run from one place to another. And I think this is my last slide, where we need to do more research. I already mentioned we need more clinical trials for TB, but apart from that, we need to see how we can reduce mortality in these co-infected. There's still very high rates of mortality. How can we prevent TB? How we need more research on biomarkers that can detect TB early and that can predict disease progression. More data on pharmacokinetics, optimizing treatment in children, shorter, safer, more convenient regimens, both for drug-sensitive and drug-resistant TB, and some models of service integration, and different models of care at the community level. Once again, thank you very much for this honor and for your attention.